Isaiah chapter 65, which really answers the question that was on the minds of the Jewish people at this time, especially. And that's, well, where are we headed? Not just as individuals, but where are we headed as a community, as a nation, as a people group? What's in store for us? Because you by now know the context. The first 39 chapters of Isaiah are all written before the Babylonian captivity, which occurred in 587 BC. It actually went on, of course, the siege went on longer than that, but that's when Jerusalem fell, so we mark it at that time. From chapters 40 on to the end, we are dealing with the time after the Babylonian captivity. So Babylon was conquered by Persia, and Persia, of course, allowed those Jews who wanted to and those who could afford it to repatriate the land. And so, you know, we're in that time. We're in the first couple of decades after people have started coming back into the land. And, you know, and if you look at a map, that's a long, gruesome trip. You look where Babylon is between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, and you couldn't in those days go straight across because there's a huge desert there. So they would always, when they traveled, they would follow the Fertile Crescent, which meant you went up the Tigris-Euphrates Valley towards the north, and then it hooked over into what would be modern-day Syria, and then down the coast through what would be modern-day Lebanon and into what would be modern-day Israel. So it was a long, arduous journey. So a lot of people couldn't afford to make it. Some people were not physically able to make it. But those that were coming back into the land under the leadership of Ezra, Nehemiah, and Zerubbabel. And of course, as we've seen, they started out with all these great hopes. Yay, we're going back into our land. It's a land flowing with milk and honey. We've never seen it. We were born in captivity, most of us. But we've heard these stories about what a beautiful place it is and magnificent temple. Well, they get there and it looks like, you know, Lahaina does now. It's just devastated. It's just rubble, ashes. And not only that, but there are various groups of people that are opposed to them coming back, and they're struggling. They're fighting against them. They're under threat politically, and they're under threat militarily. A lot of hardships. So, you know, they're crying out to God. And we saw that really long prayer in chapter 64, actually starts in chapter 63 and then goes through chapter 64. And now in chapter 65, God is answering that prayer. And he's basically telling them, in answer to the question, what's in store for us, two things: judgment and new creation. Of course, that's really what's in store for all of us, not just the nation of Israel, but also the nation of the United States of America. Also us as individuals. It's appointed unto humans once to die, and then the judgment. And we live in the constant hope of the appearing of Jesus, when heaven will come to earth and God is going to make all things new. So that's what's in store for us. Now, when we talk about judgment, don't think of condemnation. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about God refining us, making us into his image, refining our character for the end goal, which is for all of us to reflect the nature of Jesus. We shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. From this time on, I think it's important to underscore the fact that from this time on, well, really from 587 BC on, almost 600 years before the birth of Jesus, Israel is never politically independent again. They are conquered. Well, a lot of Israel was conquered by Assyria back in 722 BC. The area around Jerusalem, called Judea, hung on until 587. But from then on, they were under the thumb of first Babylon and then Persia and then the Seleucid Greek Empire and then, of course, Rome. And in 70 AD, Rome totally, completely destroyed the nation of Israel. So ancient Israel is never politically independent again from this time on. And that doesn't fit with their image of themselves. That doesn't fit with what they had hoped for. And so they're crying out to God, as we saw in that prayer in chapter 64. And now God begins to answer that prayer. What's in store for us? Well, first of all, judgment. God says, I was ready to be sought out by those who did not ask, to be found by those who did not seek me. I said, here I am, to a nation that did not call on my name. I held out my hands all day long to a rebellious people who walk in a way that is not good, following their own devices, a people who provoke me to my face continually, sacrificing in gardens and offering incense on bricks, apparently references to the way that they were worshiping these false gods, these idols, who sit inside tombs and spend the night in secret places, who eat the flesh of pigs with broth of abominable things in their vessels, who say, keep to yourself, do not come near me, for I am too holy for you. So God is calling them to task. He's calling them to task for following their own devices, is the phrase that God uses there. And of course, when human beings follow their own devices, it historically leads to all kinds of evil. I mean, we can make a list, right? War and poverty and slavery and injustice of all different kinds, environmental pollution, and so forth. The saddest thing is that they did not learn the lesson from their exile. Here they, as a nation, they've been through all of this. They've seen the northern kingdom of Israel completely crushed, destroyed by the Assyrians way back 700 plus years before the birth of Jesus. They themselves have been crushed, their nation destroyed by the Babylonians almost 600 years before the birth of Jesus. They've been in captivity, now they're coming back, but they still haven't learned the lesson. They're still turning away from God. They're still not responding to God's calls to come and receive his love. And that's terribly tragic, but it underscores an important point, I think. And that is that hardship does not necessarily bring people to Christ. Sometimes we think, well, you know, if Uncle so-and-so is so hard-hearted and, you know, maybe if he goes through it, he's going through a rough time, this is going to turn him around. Well, I pray it will, but it might not. I've seen, you know, as a pastor, as a chaplain, as a counselor, I've seen people go through horrendous things and still not come to the Lord. So, trials and tribulations, God will use them. God doesn't cause them, but God will use them in our lives to refine us and make us more like Jesus if we allow him to. But if we don't, if we push God away, if we thrash and fuss and all we are is angry at the trial and the tribulation, then it doesn't necessarily have any positive spiritual effect on us. So they were following their own devices and they were filled with pride. Don't come near me. I'm holier than you are. That's the worst kind of pride because it's religious arrogance. It leads to legalism. It leads to judgmentalism. It leads to exclusivism. My little group is in and your little group is out and you're not like us, so we reject you. We have a corner on the truth. We need what I would call a hermeneutical humility. Hermeneutics is the way that we understand, study the scriptures. We need humility. We, in the sense that we need to realize we don't have all the answers. We and you know, my interpretation of this particular passage might be right on. It might be way off. It might be something in between. I always need to be open and teachable. We don't want to be self-righteous. We don't want to be holier than thou. But don't you love that picture that God says, all day long, I stretch forth my hands to a people that are not even looking for me. I'm calling out, here I am, here I am, so that they will come running to me. And of course, in context, Yahweh is speaking and is stretching out his arms to the nation of Israel. But those first two verses in chapter 65 are quoted by Paul in Romans chapter 10 as referring to Jesus on the cross, stretching out his arms to all people, not just Jews, but Gentiles, not just, you know, people that are learned or wealthy, but to the down and out. Blessed are the poor, blessed are the meek, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. You know, the verse is taken by Paul to a much broader meaning than it was originally thought of as Isaiah was putting it down. Isaiah's thinking of Yahweh stretching out his arms to Israel, but it goes way beyond that. It really is God stretching out his arms to every person and every people group. God goes on in verse 5, these, that is those who are rebelling against him, are a smoke in my nostrils, a fire that burns all day long. See, it is written before me, I will not keep silent, but I will repay. I will indeed repay into their laps their iniquities and their ancestors' iniquities together. You're like smoke in my nostrils, noxious. You know, something you want to get away from. God is not pleased. They have not learned their lesson. They are still worshiping false gods. And we'll see an example of that in just a moment. But before we do, notice that he says that I'm going to bring judgment to you for your iniquities and also for your ancestors' iniquities. And you know, at first reading, that doesn't sound fair. But there is a connection, you know. A lot of times, there are people that are complicit in the sin. You know, for example, when you look historically at the Civil War era in the United States of America, it would be wrong to conclude that it was all a Southern problem, because the Southern plantation owners and the Northern industrialists were complicit together in chattel slavery. You know, many of the Northern communities got to the place where they no longer had slaves, but they were benefiting from slavery. And you can carry that forward, you know. I mean, I'm what they call a white guy. I hate that term because there's no such thing as a white race. That is an invention to justify chattel slavery. There's only one race. It's the human race. We have various skin tones because our ancestors lived in various places on the globe. But, you know, there's only one race. And obviously, yeah, you know, there's a lot of talk nowadays about reparations and such. And, you know, people say things like, well, you know, nobody's enslaved today. I mean, in the normal population, there are modern day slaves, but in the normal population, the regular population, nobody's enslaved today and nobody owns slaves. I don't own any slaves, so why should I pay reparations? Well, it's true. I've never owned any slaves. In fact, I've always been opposed to slavery. I've always been opposed to Jim Crow segregation. I've always been on the side of civil rights and a supporter of civil rights. So am I one of the good guys? Well, maybe, but I nevertheless, just because my skin is a lighter color than some people, have benefited from slavery, have benefited from segregation, had opportunities that other people don't have. My parents had opportunities other people didn't have. My grandparents had opportunities other people didn't have. So, you know, it's like, you know, I was born on second or third base. So there is a corporate understanding that we've got to get our minds around. And that's not to say that any individual feels guilty. I don't feel guilty personally because of slavery. I wasn't around. I had nothing to do with that. It's not a matter of guilt. It's a matter of justice. It's a matter of making things right. But the point is that good people who say nothing are complicit in injustice. In verse 8, the Lord says, as the wine is found in the cluster, think of a cluster of grapes, and they say, do not destroy it, for there is a blessing in it. So I will do for my servants' sake and not destroy them all. I will bring forth descendants from Jacob and from Judah, inheritors of my mountains. My chosen shall inherit it. My servants shall settle there. Judgment is always in the scripture tempered with mercy. And why is that? Because God sees good in the worst of us. And when we talk about judgment in the biblical concept, we're not talking about punishment. We're not talking about pain for the sake of pain. We're talking about the natural consequences of sin. God, in his love, allows some of the natural consequences of sin to adversely affect the lives of human beings so that he can then use those adverse circumstances to change us into his image, to refine us, to burn away everything that's unlike Jesus, and to cause everything that is like Jesus in our character to shine forth. So when we talk about judgment, it isn't something that God does to people. It's just the natural consequences of sin. And as a result of sin, I wind up in a mess. And then God comes along. God didn't cause the mess, but God comes along and uses the mess to, if I'll allow him, to make me more like Jesus. In God's heart, it's always about restorative justice, not punitive justice. It's not about just, you were a bad person, so I'm going to spank you. It's always about restoring a person or restoring a people group, in this case, to a place of unity with God. And why does God do that? Because God is the only source of life and of joy and of love and of peace and of safety. And so when we push him away, we're pushing away life. We're pushing away joy. We're pushing away safety. We're pushing away goodness. And we wind up with these adverse circumstances. God uses them to refine us, to make us more like Jesus, and to bring us back into relationship with him. God's goal in all of our lives is making us like Christ. For this we know, that when Christ shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. By the time Jesus appears, we hopefully will have submitted to enough refinement that we will be like Jesus, and then we can see him as he really is. Dr. King said there's some good in the worst of us and some evil in the best of us. When we discover this, we're less prone to hate our enemies. Jump down with me, if you're following along in your Bible, to verse 11, where there's a reference to a couple of false gods. One is named Fortune, and the other is named Destiny. We really don't know. Scholars try to identify these with names of false gods that that are known from other sources of literature. But as far as I can tell, no one knows exactly which idol is being referred to here. But obviously, the one called Fortune is a god or goddess of luck, of happenstance, and the one called Destiny is a god of misfortune, not just destiny in the sense of what's going to happen, but bad things that could happen. The point is that idolatry is trusting in anything other than God as the source of life, love, and fulfillment. Jesus said, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is life. Jesus is love. Jesus is light. There is no life. There is no love. There is no light apart from Jesus. So if we're trusting in anything other than God as the source of life, as what gives us meaning, as what gives us purpose, as what makes us feel like we are fulfilled. And, you know, there are a lot of things that can fall into that category. A couple of the big ones that you run into all the time, some people, their family is their source of life. I mean, and there's nothing wrong with enjoying your family. By all means, do so. But it's what they're looking at. And if they get to the place, say physically, where they can't any longer do that, then they lose all hope of living because they're drawing all their life from interactions with family or with friends, or they're drawing all their life from their careers or all their life from the gaining of power or controlling and so forth. Idolatry is trusting anything other than God as the source of life, of love, of fulfillment, and therefore, it's vanity to follow after those things. But notice the shift that occurs in verse 17. God's been talking about judgment. You know, the people have been crying out, what's to become of us? What's in store for us? We thought we were going to come back here and have this gorgeous land and, you know, big, beautiful houses to live in and a magnificent temple to worship God in. And we were going to live in prosperity and have our best life now and all that nonsense. Instead, of course, they came back and they found rubble and ruin and opposition. So they're crying out, what's in store for us? And God says, well, first of all, judgment's in store for you because you've turned away from the source of love. You've turned away from the source of life. You've turned away from the source of goodness. So you're bringing this bad stuff on yourself. But I'm going to take that bad stuff, if you'll let me, and I'm going to use it for your good. All things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. Everything doesn't work together for good if you're running away from God. But if you love God, God will use every circumstance in your life. He doesn't cause the bad ones, but he will use every circumstance in your life to bring you closer to his heart. He doesn't cause sickness. He doesn't cause pain. He doesn't cause grief and loss and so forth. But God can use those things to draw us closer to him. And what's ultimately ahead of us, what's ultimately ahead of Israel, what's ultimately ahead of all of us, is a new creation. Verse 17, for I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating, for I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it or the cry of distress. Uninterrupted joy. Somehow, God is going to remove all the painful memories from our minds. You know, in eternity future, there's some things that you probably don't want to remember. You know, if, you know, a woman who was brutally raped doesn't want to remember that for all eternity, God's going to take away all the painful memories, all the things that if we allow them to come up in our minds, make us sad, they're going to be removed so that there will be no more for the rest of forever, no more weeping, no more grief, no more sorrow, no more death, no more separation, no more heartache. God is going to completely renew this present creation so completely that it's going to feel entirely new. God is not going to destroy the physical earth that we live on. God is not going to destroy the stars that are in the sky today, you know. God is not going to destroy this present creation. God is going to refine it. It's going to fill it with cruciform love, and in so doing, transform it so it's going to seem like a brand new place, so completely renovated. Imagine an old rundown house. And someone comes along and they buy the house. I was noticing recently, this has happened in some of the most dilapidated parts of the city of Detroit, for instance. These houses that just, you know, they were just crumbling wrecks. And the city took them over and then sold them for like a dollar. And you know, some of them, of course, were raised, but people went in and worked hard and fixed them up and made them beautiful. And some of those most dilapidated neighborhoods are now beautiful places to live. You know, that's what God's going to do to the new creation, to the creation. He's going to make it brand new. Not by destroying anything, but by making it over so that it's absolutely beautiful. His peaceable kingdom, heaven coming to earth, all of nature, the plant kingdom, the animal kingdom, all people living together in perfect peace and harmony, shalom, well-being, saturating everything that there is, the entire cosmos transformed. This is what we pray for every time we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're praying for this kingdom to come. But even now, before the kingdom fully comes, this is where we are citizens. This is where our citizenship is. We are citizens of this peaceable kingdom. We're ambassadors in a wicked world for this world that God is in the process of creating. And right now, God invites us to join him in making all things new. Everything's not completely made new until the appearance of Jesus. Jesus comes again. Heaven comes to earth. New Jerusalem, gates always open 24/7, people flowing in and out, blessed life, trees of life, rivers of living water. God, that's when the kingdom will fully come. But in the meantime, we are ambassadors representing that kingdom, invited by God to work, making, joining with God in making all things new. How do we do that? Well, we do that by developing as best we can with in cooperation with God, godly character, character that fits the kingdom of God. We do that by serving others. We do that by loving others. We do that by healing others, by going to visit the sick, and by caring for others, and by ministering to needs, and by sharing the love of Jesus as God gives us opportunity. No more shall there be in it an infant who lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. God's gift of life is what Isaiah is talking about here. Jesus came to give us life and to give it more abundantly. Death is the antithesis of God's plan. Death is the last enemy, and it was defeated by Jesus on the cross. He crushed the head of the serpent. Yes, it wounded him, but he crushed the head of the serpent. And now, risen from the dead, he breathes into us everlasting life that starts the moment you accept Jesus as your Savior. It's already here for you. It's not just something you get when you die. You're already experiencing eternal life. It's just that it keeps going. It never stops. Because you see, life is so much more than just biology. Eternal life is so much more than just a repeat of the same old thing day after day after day. It's God's gift of life is the gift of wholeness. It's the gift of shalom. It's the gift of being saturated with the love of God and connected with others and with all of nature. And it continues to grow and expand throughout all eternity. They shall build houses, verse 21 says, and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be. And my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord and their descendants as well. God is promising in his kingdom economic justice. This status quo of economic inequality, of unjust distribution of resources, is condemned throughout the Bible. How many people have spent their lives laboring to make someone else rich? Think of the billionaires. Think of the robber barons of a bygone era. How many people labored to make those other people rich? Think of a plantation with its slaves. People laboring to make somebody else rich. It's never going to be like that again. There's going to be enough for everyone. In the kingdom, all the resources are going to be available to everyone. We're going to be filled with generosity. There's going to be sharing that flows back and forth. And as kingdom people, we need to start practicing that in our individual lives now. Before they call, I will answer, God says. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like an ox. But the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Notice that the kingdom affects all of nature, not just human beings, not just a select group of human beings, but everything that God created. Wolves and lambs feeding together, lions eating straw like an ox, like a cow. But the serpent, God says, its food shall be dust. Because why? The serpent represents the Satan, and Satan has been neutralized. But all violence has been removed. Heaven has come to earth. God has made all things new. And indescribable joy fills everything. Everything. This is what's in store for us. This is what's ahead of us. You're crying out to me, God says. You're wondering what's in store for us? What's going to happen to us? You know, well, life's not working out the way we thought it would. We thought we were coming back into the land and we'd have all these nice things and we got all this trouble. Instead, God says, hey, hold on here. All day long, my arms are outstretched to you. The fact that things aren't going well is because you won't come to me. You won't let me bless you. You won't let me give you my love. But nevertheless, I'm going to pursue you, and I'm going to woo you to myself, and I'm going to bring you under my loving care. I'm going to protect you and care for you, and I'm going to bring this kingdom of mine to this earth. It's going to fill all of creation, and the entire cosmos is going to be transformed. See, people, you're whining and complaining because you don't understand. My hands are outstretched for you now. I'm going to become a human being in the person of Jesus. I'm going to demonstrate for you what this kingdom is like. I'm going to show you that this kingdom is all about love and forgiveness and other-oriented, self-sacrificial love. I'm going to show you the joy and the blessing of being fully submitted to me. And then Jesus went to the cross and stretched out those arms of love that everyone might come within the reach of his saving embrace. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your loving kindness and your grace and your mercy. Thank you, Lord, that you have promised that the whole cosmos is going to be gathered up into you. For you said in your word that God has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things into him, things in heaven and things on the earth. How we look forward to that, Lord, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Ah. God loves you so much. God has such glorious things in store for you. Now, I know a couple of you have to jump off, and I understand that, and that's fine. But before you go, stop and consider, or I invite you later on, if you know, have something you need to do right now, to exercise your creativity and imagine, what are you going to look like? Your immediate circle of friends and family. What are they going to look like? Your neighborhood. What's it going to look like when heaven comes to earth, when all things are made new? God wants us to use our imagination. You know, the ancient Christians called the human imagination the inner sanctum. It's where we can connect with the gloriousness of what God is doing. So I invite you to use your imagination and just consider, try to imagine, use your imagination to try to imagine what your world is going to look like when Jesus comes. And for those of you who can hang out with us, let's talk about this together. You know, let's bat around some ideas and see what comes of it.